Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome all of you to Austin, which is, technically speaking, still a part of Texas, and thus a fantastic spot for our second annual Texas Chapters Conference. It's my honor this morning to introduce our first speaker and my boss, Ken Paxton, the 51st Attorney General of Texas. General Paxton is a proud graduate of Baylor, which is why he got in very late last night after going to the game. He was student body president there and graduated with both a bachelor's degree and an MBA. He then went to University of Virginia for his law degree, and then practiced law at a large law firm in Dallas, in-house at a major corporation, and at his own small firm. Before he was elected Attorney General, General Paxton served in the Texas House of Representatives for 10 years and in the Texas Senate for 2 years. Ladies and gentlemen, General Paxton.
So I appreciated Priest's comment about being technically still in Texas. So I like to tell people that, you know, I'm from North Texas, Collin County area. We have a judge here, Emily Miskell, from there. And I always tell people are always asking, you know, it's a pretty Republican county, one of the most Republican county, not just in the state, but in the country. And so I get asked all the time, you know, how do you like living in a Democratic county that's pretty liberal? And I always say, you know, I really don't mind living here because at least it's not that far from Texas. So, well, thank you for having me here. I'm truly honored to have the opportunity to welcome all of you to the second annual Texas Federalist Society Conference. The Federalist Society is near and dear to my heart. When I was a law student at the University of Virginia, the Federalist Society was a welcome respite from listening to many of my professors. It was a place where I and my fellow conservative and libertarian students could get together to listen to a few great speakers talk about crazy ideas like actually reading and applying the text of the Constitution and statutes. And this is particularly a great day to hold this conference. In case you don't know, today is Constitution Day. On this date, 229 years ago, the delegates to the Constitutional Convention of Philadelphia sign that great document. I'm reminded of a Daniel Webster quote mentioned by President Reagan during the investiture of Chief Justice Rehnquist and Justice Scalia in 1986. "Hold on, my friends, to the Constitution and to the Republic for which it stands. Miracles do not cluster, and what has happened once in 6,000 years may not happen again. Hold on to the Constitution, for if the American Constitution should fail, there will be anarchy throughout the world." I know that I'm preaching to the choir here today, but I'm continually amazed by our Constitution and the foresight of our founding fathers to enact a system of government that has truly stood the test of time. But I'm not sure even they could have foreseen the topic of our conference today, the rise of the administrative state. Just consider what Madison wrote in Federalist 62. "It will be of little avail to the people that the laws are made by men of their own choice, if the laws be so voluminous that they cannot be read, or so incoherent that they cannot be understood, or undergo such incessant changes that no man who knows what the law is today can guess what it will be tomorrow." In other words, Madison's fear was that the people choosing their Congress was little consolation if Congress passed lengthy or incoherent laws or changed the laws all the time. But if we fast forward from 1788 to 2016, we are faced with a situation that is worse than Madison could have ever imagined. In that one sentence from Federalist 62, Madison expressed three fears of how an elected Congress could go wrong. But he at least took comfort that the people would be electing representatives of their choosing and would be able to hold those representatives accountable at the ballot box. That isn't true anymore. Instead of electing representatives to write laws, we have no say in selecting the administrative agency bureaucrats that make laws in an entirely unaccountable fashion. If these bureaucrats fail miserably, they might lose a court case, but they certainly don't lose their jobs. So that one solace Madison had is gone. But the three fears he wrote about are still here, only they've been further exacerbated by the administrative state. The first fear Madison expressed proves this point. Madison's first fear was voluminous laws. The combined U.S. code that Congress enacted currently takes up 73 inches of shelf space. But the code of federal regs that the bureaucrats have promulgated take up over 300 inches of shelf space. By my calculation, that's at least four times the size of the U.S. code. Since Mike Lee often refers to another shocking statistic, in 2014, 3,291 pages of new laws were passed by Congress and signed by the President of the United States. During the same period, unelected bureaucrats at dozens of federal departments and agencies issued, listen to this, 79,066 pages of new and updated regulations. That's almost 25 times more pages of regulations than the laws passed by Congress. And unfortunately, that number doesn't even cover the sheer scope of the problem we face. Forget the rules. Whether you're talking about immigration or bathrooms, there are plenty of agency decisions that should have gone through notice and comment rulemaking, but didn't. And yet, those guidelines now are the force of law. Madison's second fear was that the laws would be incoherent. He sure got that right. Anyone who has litigated against the federal government recently knows full well the incoherence that is on display there. Consider a lawsuit that my office filed this summer changing the federal government's guidance on Title IX in bathrooms. Perhaps you've heard of it. One little noticed aspect of that case is that in addition to Title IX, there's also a rule that the federal government is relying on. The rule provides, and I quote, a recipient may provide separate toilet, locker room, and shower facilities on the basis of sex, but such facilities provided for students of one sex shall be comparable to such facilities provided for students of the other sex. So the rule means entities that receive federal funds can have sex-specific restrooms. But the feds are now arguing that a rule means the exact opposite of what it says, that sex-specific restrooms can no longer be sex-specific. That is the very definition of incoherent. And finally, Madison's final fear was that the laws would change incessantly. Take the Department of Labor's overtime rule. If you don't know what that is, it is a particular pernicious new rule that threatens to affect countless industries. The new rule concerns the salary someone can make while still being eligible for overtime pay. In 2004, the rule was updated to set the level at around $24,000 a year. Now, the Labor Department has passed a new rule, setting the level at $48,000. They've doubled it. But let's forget the fact that the government just doubled the number without passing it in or even considering the dramatic effects that change will have on business. One of the most galling things about this new rule is that it includes an automatic indexing mechanism to ratchet up the salary level every 3 years without regard for current economic conditions or the effect on public and private resources. They're now inventing new ways to make incessant changes to the law. By the way, I'll just say that you should stay tuned on that overtime rule. I'm just not sure it can withstand judicial scrutiny. And we here in Texas are pretty good at putting federal regulations under judicial scrutiny. Getting back to my original point, as you can see, every single fear of Madison's has come to fruition. And they become even more pronounced because of the administrative state. So if the feds are Madison's worst fear, my question, as you all are not all from Texas, is our state, Texas, any better? And I'll have to say, I think we are. Remember what I said earlier, there are four times as many pages of regs than laws at the federal level. How about Texas? Well, we have over 50,000 pages of statutes, that's a lot, and only 30,000 pages of regulations in the administrative code. So why the difference? Now, I can assure you there are many, many, many differences between Texas and the federal government. But when it comes to the administrative state, there is one difference in particular that is worth highlighting, and that is agency deference. I don't have much more time, so I'll just skip ahead a bit and call agency deference for what it is, unconstitutional. We know from our pocket constitution how this is supposed to work. We have three separate branches of government. Congress writes the laws, the executive faithfully executes them, and the courts interpret them. It's really not that complicated. It takes me back to my younger days listening to Schoolhouse Rock that covered that whole subject in less than 3 minutes. But when you factor federal agency deference, all of those carefully constructed checks and balances collapse into one super executive. The executive can write the law, enforce the law, and interpret the law. What a marvel of efficiency. But luckily, we do things a bit differently here in Texas. Here, and we have several members of the Supreme Court here, our Texas Supreme Court hardly ever defers to agencies. Now they do that using the same standard that federal courts often apply, namely that statutes have to be ambiguous for an agency to get deference. But our Supreme Court rightfully reviews that as a very high hurdle. If you think a statute is ambiguous, you probably haven't thought about it enough. Agency deference is not bigger in Texas, but it is better in Texas because we have courts that understand their role and are not afraid to stand up to agencies that are trying to interpret law. And there's no reason why we can't make America a bit more like Texas. It's time for federal courts to take Texas's lead and return us back to our Constitution, a system that continues to work. Madison's worst fears may have come true on the federal level, but hope and change really are possible. So I want to welcome you all to Austin, a little bit liberal here, and I hope that this conference will stimulate some discussion and give you all the tools that you need to achieve the goals that we all share. I really appreciate what you guys do, not just for being at the conference, but I appreciate the impact that I believe that you're having on the legal system and on the entire country. So God bless you for being here, and God bless you for what you're doing for our country. Thank you very much.
I will be introducing our first moderator for panel one. As I do that, I would like to take a look at the setting in which this panel discussion occurs this morning. When President Obama took office, he promised a transformation. And as the Heritage Foundation has recently summarized, this transformation, when it comes to the legal landscape, has changed the way that our circuit courts are comprised. With his 55 appointees thus far, we now have seen a transition from legal liberal dominance of one circuit court of appeal when he took office to now with 70% of the judges at the circuit court level being of the liberal predisposition, there now are 9 circuit courts that are dominated by liberal judges. And so these would be the judges who would harness law to serve ends like social justice and the enhancement of the administrative state. So yet, and this is such an important yet, there are judges like the judge I'll be introducing this morning who will be the force that will continue to undergird the structure, the very important structural separation of powers, the balance of powers with the states. These judges will underscore the important rule of law issues that come from constitutional principles and the standards that are so important to what our founders created. So, it is indeed an honor and a privilege this morning to introduce Judge Edith Jones, Fifth Circuit Court of Appeal. She has been on the bench for just over 30 years, was appointed by President Reagan, and she was a partner before that in the law firm of Andrews & Kurth for 11 years. She's well known here and loved for having attended the University of Texas School of Law, where she graduated with honors and Order of the Coif. She has been awarded the Leon Green Award by the University Law Review. In 2010, Judge Jones visited Iraq as part of a U.S. State Department Rule of Law program where she advised and encouraged Iraqi and Kurdish judges. She sits on the board of directors of the Sam Houston Area Council of Boy Scouts of America. I am from California, and so coming to Texas and now having two grandsons who are in the Scout program. This was a conversation that I had with Judge Jones last night because she's highly involved in actually awarding young men in Texas who are in the Boy Scout program notice for the fact that they have intervened in an emergency situation and saved people's lives. So this is quite an important service, and I am proud now to be in a state where Boy Scouts are recognized as a respected and one of the programs that, as far as the schools go, is something that is very viable. And then finally, she has been awarded the 2003 Silver Beaver Award by the Boy Scouts of America. So I am very honored and so grateful that Judge Jones could be with us today to moderate this first panel on Chevron deference. Judge Jones.
Good morning. I'm very glad to be here. Glad you're all here. I tried to wear something close to burnt orange, but you know, what can I, best I could do. It's not my color. And you know, I may have been on the bench a long time, but I was only 15 when I got appointed, so. Reagan wanted young judges. I'd like my panel members to come up here because all I am is the moderator, and it's not about me, and of course it's not about them, it's about Chevron, and therefore it's about the rule of law. And I think the Attorney General spoke very eloquently, and I won't repeat it. But believe me, I've thought a lot, and particularly since I went to Iraq, but I have thought a great deal about the challenges that we face to the rule of law right now. And this is going to be a really interesting and multifaceted discussion of what the Chevron doctrine has to do about that. Now, I have been asked to say a word or two about Chevron versus Natural Resources Defense Council because perhaps many of you, and I know even judges on our court, do not have as much experience with that doctrine as, let's say, our friends in the D.C. Circuit because the Chevron rule was invented by Justice Stevens in 1984 in order. Well, someone here, probably Aditya, knows why, but one thing that it was doing at the time was making the job of federal judges easier because all you had to do to review an agency interpretation of the law was say that the governing law was unclear, and if the governing law was unclear or ambiguous, which is a term that can be abused, then you would proceed to the second step of the Chevron test of the agency rule and declare whether it was reasonable or unreasonable. And any of you know from having talked about the reasonable man that includes a wide variety of possibilities, many of which can be wrong. So Chevron deference has provided a big opening for the agencies to authorize new regulations in, as they say, they're working in the interstices of the law. But that raises serious questions about not only the statute, the Administrative Procedure Act, but also the Constitution. So the Federalist Society has gotten a great panel to discuss those issues. Our first speaker is going to be Aditya Bhamsai. Aditya clerked for Justice Scalia about 8 years ago, and if I need to remind you, Justice Scalia, before he went on the bench, was the head of the Administrative Conference of the United States because administrative law was one of his areas of expertise. And not only that, but he was the rare professor who actually intermingled with real practitioners of law in that capacity. So he actually had some real experience in practicing law before he went on the bench, all of which contributed to the immense skill that he brought to the judicial craft. But Aditya is going to focus on the history and the doctrine of judicial deference to administrative lawmaking and talk about Chevron and its relation to the Administrative Procedure Act. Our second speaker is Professor Ron Beal from Baylor, who is the guru of administrative regulation in the state of Texas, has published a book on the subject, and I'm sure it's in all the offices of people who do that kind of regulatory work. And he's going to be defending Chevron and also discussing some of Justice Scalia's evolution on his views of the Chevron doctrine, because originally when Chevron came in, I personally think that, or well, I have reason to believe that a lot of judicial conservatives thought that this was going to be a way not to cabin the administrative agencies, but to cabin the D.C. Circuit, which in the 70s and 80s had its own little effusion of regulatory ambition by overturning what agencies were trying to do in the Nixon and Ford administrations. Third speaker is going to be Professor Aaron Nielsen, whom I've known since he was a baby law clerk for Judge Jerry Smith. And Aaron is now a professor at BYU, who I understand is prolific on Twitter on various subjects, which I'll never know about because I don't do Twitter. And he's going to be discussing a very important offshoot of Chevron, which is deference to the administrative agency's interpretation of their own regulations, which is called the Seminole Rock and the Hour ideas of deference. And then winding up as the grand slam hitter in the lineup will be my friend Chuck Cooper, who clerked on the 11th Circuit when he was a baby, and is most recently in the news because he was involved in some litigation in Virginia about certain voting rights. But Chuck has been was in the Justice Department during the Reagan administration. He's been behind the scenes in a lot of policy making on the conservative side of legal matters for some years, and also an active member of the Federalist Society and a great litigator as well. So I welcome the panel, and we'll start with Aditya.
Thank you, Judge Jones, for the introduction. So at least half the title of this panel refers to the evolution of Chevron deference. And in order to have a productive discussion about Chevron's evolution, it's necessary to begin with a discussion of where the doctrine began, which may naturally raise the question whether there's a connection between the origins and evolution of judicial deference and the justifications for it. A fair amount of the debate in the three decades since Chevron has occurred on a quite different ground, whether the rule announced in the case appropriately strikes the balance between courts and executive agencies. But one way that an historical approach can be relevant is to help us figure out whether that balance has already been struck by Congress or by the Constitution in the form of some sort of authoritative text or a sufficiently embedded legal practice to rise to the level of authoritativeness. On the question of Chevron, broadly speaking, there are two legal texts on point. First, there's the federal constitution, specifically Article III's grant of the judicial power to the courts and the due process clause. And second, the Administrative Procedure Act, which was enacted in 1946 and which provides that, quote, a reviewing court shall decide all relevant questions of law, end quote, interpret constitutional and statutory provisions, end quote. So I'll bracket for present purposes the nuance that some other statutory provision, perhaps an organic statute, expressly or impliedly bears on the topic of Chevron. So let's start with the Constitution. In a set of opinions, and I'm sure you all are familiar with these by now in recent terms, justices on the Supreme Court, including Justice Scalia, argued that Chevron deference and its close cousin Seminole Rock deference raise serious separation of powers concerns by precluding judges from using their own independent judgment in deciding legal questions. The kind of independent judgment that's consistent in this view with Article III's institutional role for the federal judiciary. The takeaway is that writ large, de novo review is mandated and deferential review prohibited by the lodging of the judicial power in the federal courts. So how can we assess this claim? A term like judicial power doesn't just define itself. We have to look to historical practices to see precisely what the boundaries of the court system were understood to be at the time that Article III was adopted and perhaps sometime shortly thereafter. And there are at least three practices that might cause us to better understand and to qualify the claim that Article III prohibits deferential review. So I'm going to address these three. First, for much of the nation's history, review of certain but not all federal action occurred through the use of the writ of mandamus or some other type of extraordinary writ. This is a point that Justice Scalia himself made in his dissent in United States versus Meade Corporation, where he said, and this is a quote, judicial control of federal executive officers was principally exercised through the prerogative writ of mandamus, and the writ generally would not issue unless the executive officer was acting plainly beyond the scope of his authority. So in other words, as we know from appellate practice today, the writ of mandamus carries with it a deferential standard of review. And similarly, as articulated in a series of 19th century cases, to obtain a writ of mandamus against a federal officer, you had to show that the officer had violated a, quote, ministerial duty. That actually comes from Marbury versus Madison, if you go and look back to some of Chief Justice Marshall's discussion in that case. And in an 1840 opinion, Decatur versus Paulding, the court held that this standard confers interpretive discretion on executive officers. So the act of interpreting a statute itself was non-ministerial and hence not reviewable by mandamus. So this history suggests the following. At least for the kinds of claims that were brought through a writ of mandamus, during the 19th century, deferential review is constitutionally permissible. So here's a counterfactual to test the thesis. Let's say that Congress created a statutory scheme with review of government action only by writ of mandamus and with respect to a kind of claim historically reviewable by mandamus. Would that scheme be constitutional? Would it carry a deferential standard of review? As an initial matter, let me suggest that the answer is yes and yes. If you agree that mandamus comes with a deferential standard of review for legal questions, and you agree that the nation's historical practice of mandamus review colors the meaning of the judicial power. But by contrast, review in the early republic was not always conducted through the writ of mandamus, with the other avenue typically being common law causes of action. And it could be argued that Article III does mandate de novo review for the kinds of claims brought via common law rather than mandamus during the 19th century. And so that's the first nuance, and it connects the standard of review to the type of claim brought. Second, if you think about it, there's a form of, quote, deference that's built into the structure of interpretation itself. And I think the best way that I can make this point is by analogy to a case from the realm of constitutional interpretation. So in the recent recess appointments case, Noel Canning, which I'm basically picking that case at random, there are many other examples, Justice Breyer's opinion cites three opinions of the United States Attorney General from 1868 in the course of interpreting the recess appointments clause. So why is that? Well, the obvious answer is that under appropriate circumstances, the court, quote, respects or defers to certain persuasive executive branch sources that are either roughly contemporaneous with the enactment of a constitutional provision or provide evidence of a customary practice that is developed under that provision. In other words, de novo constitutional review itself contains a form of what we might call deference to customary and contemporaneous practices. And so, this is the second nuance, executive branch interpretations can be used to construe the terms of the federal constitution itself under appropriate circumstances. But notice the wrinkle. Justice Breyer invokes the customary executive branch interpretations to reject a present-day executive branch interpretation. Chevron is later elaborated in cases like Brand X allows the executive branch to change its interpretation of a legal text based on changing circumstances. In fact, if you look at Chevron itself, you'll find that the opinion cites a number of cases dating back to the Marshall Court era as support for the rule that the court announces. The earliest one of these is an 1827 opinion in Edwards Lissie versus Darby, which says that when construing an ambiguous law, quote, the contemporaneous construction of those called upon to act under the law is entitled to very great respect. This is Justice Breyer's point from the recess appointments case applied in the statutory context. Deference to customary understanding, contemporaneous understanding to settle the meaning of text over time. The Chevron opinion and later Chevron doctrine simply misunderstands what these cases were actually about. The bottom line is that on the plane of interpretive theory, there was and there is an interpretive rule of, quote, deference, you might call it, but a rule of deference to customary practice and contemporaneous evidence rather than the rule of deference to executive expertise and allowing executive flexibility that we're more familiar with today. So the statutory cases cited in Chevron, as I mentioned a few moments ago, they're just an application of this generalized approach. Third, the court has long applied a form of deference, sometimes under the rubric of the political question doctrine, in certain substantive areas, most notably foreign affairs and national security. So in cases like Curtis Wright, that's a 1936 case, or Department of Navy versus Egan, that's a more recent 1988 opinion, the court has explained that, and this is a quote, congressional legislation within the international field must often accord the president a degree of discretion and freedom from statutory restriction which would not be admissible were domestic affairs alone involved, and that unless Congress specifically has provided otherwise, courts traditionally should be reluctant to intrude upon the authority of the executive in military and national security affairs. So these cases rely on precedents that date all the way back into the early 19th century about deference in the context of national security or in foreign affairs. That suggests that the argument that Article III prohibits deferential review needs to be qualified with the recognition that in these certain substantive areas, deferential review has historically been viewed as constitutionally permissible. I mentioned at the start of my talk that two legal texts are relevant to the question posed by Chevron. It's time to turn to the second, the text of the APA. That text says, in a nutshell, that a reviewing court shall decide all relevant questions of law and interpret constitutional and statutory provisions. And as the face of the text indicates, the most plausible interpretation of the Act is that it seeks to equate the interpretive approach for the federal constitution and the interpretive approach to statutes. And what that means is that the Act seeks, broadly speaking, to establish de novo review coupled with what we might call deference to contemporaneous and customary interpretations, as in the recess appointments case. So consider two pieces of evidence on the point. First, the text of the statute itself that says that courts must interpret constitutional and statutory provisions. So there's a parallelism there. What that suggests is that statutory and constitutional interpretation should be conducted more or less in the same general manner. Second, if you look at the statutory history of this part of the APA, in enacting the judicial review provision, Congress took as the baseline a pre-existing proposed bill with a single glaring alteration. Congress removed a proviso that would have required a reviewing court to give, quote, due weight to agency technical competence and specialized knowledge. So this is a proviso removed by the 1946 Congress. There's a lot to be said about the statutory and case law developments that led to the APA's adoption. But rather than go into that nitty-gritty, let me step back and make a larger conceptual point. One of the important justifications for the rule announced in Chevron is that notwithstanding any subsequent caveats and qualifications, at least it sets forth a legal standard of greater rule-like simplicity than the alternative. And there's some truth to that. But take a broader view about interpretation generally, comparing statutory interpretation to constitutional interpretation or even contract interpretation, where we have the analogs to contemporaneous and customary practice in the parole evidence rule or course of conduct. What Chevron does is it introduces a complication by suggesting that the interpretation of some public legal documents, namely statutory legal text, ought to be done differently than the interpretation of other legal text in other public legal documents, like contracts or like the Constitution. And the question I'll leave everybody with is, should we have one standard of review for public documents, the Constitution, statutes, and regulations generally, or should we have different doctrines for each different kind of legal text? Thank you.
It's a pleasure to be here. I am Ron Beal, and maybe not looked at too favorably. I come to try to defend Chevron show that it is consistent with the Constitution. We hear this a lot, that the Chevron doctrine takes the decision-making out of the courts, and therefore it violates separation of powers. I think we should look at this from a very basic and fundamental way to see that that does not occur, and that the courts are doing their job, and I think in a beneficial way. Now, I know a lot of people think the administrative state is too big, that maybe we should eliminate it. But the fact is, it's here, and I'm looking at this from the point of view of it's here and it's probably here to stay, and what we need to do is deal with it from the point of view of how it impacts the citizenry of the United States. What are we talking about? We're talking about statutory interpretation, and maybe it's because it's the professor in me want to go back to basics. Because I think it has a tremendous impact as to why Chevron is a good doctrine. And that is, what is the constitutional job of the courts? And that is to interpret the law. Specifically, that means what? The Congress makes the law, not the courts, and therefore the court's job is merely to interpret. And therefore, if the law is clear and unambiguous, the only job of the court is to apply that law as written. But as we all know, many times, and we can fight for a long time, what is an ambiguity? Many statutes are ambiguous. And basically, what do we mean by that? And we mean that we have at least two or more reasonable interpretations of the statute as to the legislative intent. Meaning, we don't know what the legislature intended. And I think that's what gets lost in this, is that if we resolve this ambiguity, we are merely making, and should I say this, it's probably dangerous right beside a judge, educated guessing. Educated guessing. Because what do we admit? We admit there is no true answer. Because where do ambiguities come from? Where the legislature doesn't even see the problem, the legislature leaves terms undefined, which in their context don't make sense. They fail to even see the issue, or as was brought up in Chevron, sometimes, and it appeared to be true in Chevron, that in Congress, there wasn't a majority view as to what the law should mean. They couldn't get it passed, and so they merely adopted the law with the ambiguity and just let the interpretation to be done by the courts, and therefore dropped it in their lap. So we come to the court system, and the court system is there to interpret what the law means. All right, how do we interpret the law? Well, when we're in this situation where we don't know the specific intent of Congress, we have canons of construction. And what no one seems to bring up, those canons guide the court as to the decision that they make. Example, that when you have a remedial statute and you can't decide between two reasonable constructions, the rule says choose the broader, because we presume that Congress, we presume that Congress intended the broader meaning, not based upon the language of the statute, but based upon the canon. Because you might even ask, and I even thought about this when I went to law school, is that when there is an ambiguity and there is two or more reasonable constructions of a statute, why does the court go ahead and attempt to decide it? Why don't we send it back to the legislature and say, this is unconstitutionally vague? Oh, we don't do that. No, we proceed with our canons of construction to make our educated guess as to what the law is. So, what happened with Chevron? Well, Chevron was dealing with a problem of what was the meaning of stationary source. And there were two reasonable interpretations. What did the court devise as its doctrine? You know, we can look historically. I think one thing that we should bring up along the way that seems to get kind of lost is the Skidmore doctrine. We had the Skidmore doctrine before the Chevron doctrine, and we still have Skidmore around in certain circumstances. Skidmore looks a lot like Chevron, and I think you could argue actually is Chevron that we've had for a long time. Because what is the intent of the court in doing this? When they're dealing with not knowing the precise intent of Congress, they have to apply, make a decision, and apply it in a manner that is consistent. And therefore, what did they set up? First, whether Congress has directly spoken to the precise question at issue. If the intent of Congress is clear, that is the end of the matter for the court and the agency. For the court must give effect to the unambiguously expressed intent of Congress. How can we object to step one of the Chevron doctrine? The court is doing what it is historically always done, and that is, without deference to the agency, is substituting judgment, is this statute clear and unambiguous? And therefore, clearly, it's constitutional. So then we go to step two. And I noticed there were some chuckles when we talked a little bit earlier about the doctrine, is that in step two, the court will adopt an agency interpretation if it is a reasonable one. Well, many people say that means that the agency interpretation is going to apply. Well, I would beg to differ. The court is still in control when they are making this interpretation. They have to determine, is it reasonable? Is it reasonable? Now, yes, that's broad, but we deal with that standard in all of the law. But they have to, but the reasonableness is reasonable, consistent with the legislative intent. In other words, the court has the authority to determine, even though we don't know the precise answer to this question, is it consistent with the overall language of the statute? Just last week, I was looking over a couple cases, one of them being, I got to put on my glasses, sorry, MCI Telecommunications versus AT&T, which was a 1994 decision, and then Michigan, that's what it is, Michigan versus the EPA, both written by Justice Scalia. And in that those cases, he meticulously demonstrates how the agency's interpretation is unreasonable and sets it aside. And therefore, the court can police the agency interpretation. And all we're looking for is, because we don't have an answer to the question, we don't have an answer, what did the legislature really intend? Is that we are ensuring that a reasonable interpretation consistent with the legislative intent is applied in each of these cases. So I assert that the court is in control and is applying the law correctly. It's not that we are giving over to the executive branch. We are merely following the agency interpretation. What is it, does Chevron end up to be? It's a presumption that the legislature intended for that to occur. Now, whether that should be or not is a question that we can debate. I'm not necessarily sure that the Chevron doctrine has been totally beneficial all of these years, but what has it brought? Consistency and stability. In other words, back when I practiced law and I had clients that were regulated parties, what did they want? They didn't get into their business to be in the court system. They wanted to engage in their business. And therefore, they wanted clarity and they wanted consistency. And so the issue was, what does the law mean? And if we get the agency interpretation and a client comes in, what do you have to tell them? Well, you have to tell them, well, this is the agency interpretation, but the court has de novo review and therefore could substitute judgment and say that the law means something else. With Chevron, what can we tell our clients? That if it is a reasonable interpretation, and lawyers can make that determination, that is a reasonable interpretation, it is most likely going to be upheld in a court of law if, in fact, they find that they're constituted an ambiguity. So it gives consistency and stability to dealing with the administrative state, and therefore is, I think, a good doctrine. And again, I can't emphasize enough, I guess maybe I have too much faith in the judiciary, but I think they have done an excellent job of policing administrative interpretations, of ensuring that they are in fact reasonable and consistent with the legislative intent. Isn't that the best that we can wish from the judiciary when there is an ambiguity? And I come back to that again. What is an ambiguity? An ambiguity is we don't have an answer. There isn't an answer. We're just trying to determine the best that we can under the circumstances. And therefore, Chevron gives that stability and consistency and not with total deference to the administrative body, but if the administrative body has acted consistent with the legislative intent. Thank you.
So I also want to thank Judge Jones for the introduction, but I will say that if what I am most famous for is my Twitter presence, I am doing something very wrong with my career. But there we go. But I am also happy to say I checked, and I have 3 new followers now, so thank you for that. The focus of this panel is Justice Scalia and Chevron. That's why it may be surprising that I'm not really going to talk about Chevron at all, at least not directly. Instead, I'm going to speak about seminal rock deference, which is Chevron's cousin. But bear with me. I think that Justice Scalia's evolution on seminal rock deference may shed light into his views on Chevron deference. So first, what is seminal rock? Seminal rock deference is like Chevron deference, but with a twist. With Chevron, it's an agency's interpretation of a statute. A court will defer if there's an ambiguity. With seminal rock, if there's an ambiguity in an agency's own regulation, the court will defer to the agency's interpretation of its regulation. Seminal rock has been on the books since 1945. In the case, it was in the context of wartime price controls. The Supreme Court said, and I'll quote, "The administrative interpretation becomes of controlling weight unless it is plainly erroneous or inconsistent with the regulation." The agency interpretation in that case, however, was announced before the litigation in a formal interpretation that was issued contemporaneously with the regulation itself. That was how the decision was understood in that limited, narrow context. And even then, the leading treatise of the day dismissed the whole discussion of controlling weight as dicta. For years after Seminal Rock, it was understood in that narrow way. Contemporaneous, formal documents before litigation. Eventually, however, courts started drifting away from that understanding of Seminal Rock deference. And then came Justice Scalia. In a 1997 case called Auer v. Robbins, Scalia, writing for the court, adopted a very broad interpretation of Seminal Rock. Indeed, his interpretation was so broad that many now call Seminal Rock deference Auer deference. They've just replaced the original term. Auer deference is now the regime. And Auer deference is Seminal Rock deference on steroids. It is as deferential as it can possibly be. Under our, all the limits of seminal rock deference are gone. Courts will defer to informal interpretations announced long after a regulation's promulgation. Indeed, even in the very litigation itself, if there's an amicus brief from the agency, courts will defer to the agency's meaning interpretation of the regulation. So like I said, this is seminal rock slash our. This is on steroids. This is deference on steroids. And it was from Scalia. Scalia wrote it. So what's going on? Well, one of the bedrocks for understanding Justice Scalia was that he likes law to be predictable. The rule of law is a law of law. Rule of law is a law of rules. He hated a mushy five-part balancing test. So I think in our, he decided that context-specific limits didn't make any sense. All they did was complicate things. We want a good, bright line. Now, for my admin law folks out there, doesn't this kind of remind you of his dissent in Mead or his majority opinion in City of Arlington? It's the same thing. A bright line, law to be predictable, we can't have mush, and here's a bright line. But then something funny happened. One of his clerks, Professor John Manning, wrote a now classic law review article arguing that seminal rock deference violates a basic principle of separation of powers, that the same hands who write the law must not interpret it. That principle goes back to Montesquieu, Blackstone, Locke, and Manning says that if you combine these powers, the power to write the law and the power to interpret it, you get very bad incentives, because the person who writes the law will write it to be vague and ambiguous because they know that after the fact they can give meaning to it. Scalia got excited about this argument and adopted it as his own. And he did a 180-degree turn on our deference, which again, he wrote. Expressly citing Manning, he started urging that seminal rock and our be overruled. I'm going to quote Justice Thomas here. Justice Thomas was giving an anecdote about Scalia, and he said, I'm quoting Thomas, who's going to be quoting Scalia. On one occasion, he commented in typical Nino fashion that one of our opinions had become an important precedent that was, and I quote, just a horrible opinion, one of the worst ever. I thought briefly about what he had said and whispered, Nino, you wrote it. It's fun to speculate what that opinion is, but in my mind, it had to have been our. It had to have been our. Thomas is also very much in the anti-our camp, and Scalia and Thomas were holding that position. So what's the takeaway from this story? I think there are at least five. One, Scalia was willing to change his mind. He liked to quote Justice Frankfurter for the idea that wisdom too often never comes, and so one ought not to reject it merely because it comes late. I think that says something about Scalia. Two, Scalia also wanted a bright line. He wasn't going to jettison a bright line test in favor of a mushy balancing test. He just wasn't going to do it. Manning, however, gave him a bright line test. Let's just cut it off altogether, and then he got excited. Three, Scalia cared about the history. Again, he wasn't going to get rid of something just because he didn't like it. He needed something solid to ground it on. History, separation of powers, could do that for him. Four, Scalia was bold. Once he realized that what he thought was right was wrong, he switched, and then he was a tireless opponent of our. And finally, number five, I think the same pattern might have repeated itself with Chevron, perhaps based on Aditya's research. It's the same sort of thing. If you give him lines, Scalia was willing to rethink. Lines in history, he was willing to rethink even in positions that he'd adopted himself. Now, personally, I have some misgivings about overruling Seminole Rock, which I'm happy to talk about. But as to an insight into Scalia, I think the Seminole Rock story tells us a lot. That's what I got.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a real pleasure to be with you this morning. It's a special honor to be alongside Judge Jones. She said our friendship is long and enduring, and it's always great to be with her. She's a giant, to say the least, of the federal bench.
A giantess.
A giantess. and still a young and vibrant giantess. Also great privilege to be with three very highly respected, widely quoted professors of administrative law. I'm a little bit intimidated, to be honest with you. These gentlemen spend their days, day in, day out, I think, studying the administrative process and administrative agencies. I don't study administrative agencies. I sue them. And as George C. Scott said in Patton, God help me, I love it so. But I can tell you that, you know, when I was Office of Legal Counsel, as Judge Jones mentioned, I was lawyer to the administrative agencies. And Chevron was my friend, my very good friend. It was extremely potent and resulted in robust administrative activity then and now. Now that I'm on the other side of the V, it's my enemy. And I can personally confirm from my own experience the accuracy of Chief Justice John Roberts' observation in his dissenting opinion in City of Arlington against FCC that Chevron is a powerful weapon in an agency's regulatory arsenal. Ambiguity is ubiquitous in the United States Code. On that, Professor Beal, you and I very much agree. That's about the end of it, but what it means, this Chevron doctrine, is that even if you can demonstrate that the agency's interpretation is wrong, at least wrong using the traditional canons and tools of statutory construction, as the court does day in and day out, it does explicitly to determine step one, whether the statute is ambiguous itself. If you can prove using those traditional tools that the agency's interpretation is wrong, you still lose. Unless you can also show that it is unreasonable. And that's a wide, wide, wide range of interpretive authority. Professor Beal cites a couple of cases where, in fact, the agency had gone so far beyond interpretive flexibility that ambiguity provides that the court said, well, wait a second, this simply isn't reasonable. One of them was when it interpreted, I think Michigan, when it interpreted a numerical limitation on its authority to be a different numerical limitation on its authority. What else could they do with that? The chief said some other things in his dissent in City of Arlington that are worth repeating here. He lamented the danger posed by the growing power of the administrative state, and he emphasized that the framers could hardly have envisioned today's vast and varied federal bureaucracy and the authority administrative agencies hold over our economic, social, and political activities. Now, this is surely true, nor could the framers have envisioned the accumulation of all powers, executive, legislative, and judicial, in the hands of the modern administrative state. And most of you will recognize that formulation from Madison as describing the very definition of tyranny. Today, the administrative state is essentially a sovereign unto itself, a one-branch government whose regulatory grasp extends into virtually every human activity. And Chevron's rule of judicial deference to agencies has placed the regulatory power of the agencies on steroids. I got that in a tweet from Professor Neal. So I liked it, I want to use it too. Transforming them essentially into little super courts vested with the last word as to the meaning of ambiguous statutory provisions as that they administer. By the last word here, I mean that an agency's construction of an ambiguous statutory provision, so long as it is reasonable, as I said, has the force of law, controlling even over a prior contrary ruling of a federal court, a ruling based upon the ordinary tools of statutory construction, even if that ruling comes from the United States Supreme Court. The Supreme Court's ruling would be subordinate. The rationale for Chevron's judge-made rule of deference is that Congress, by enacting an ambiguous provision, implicitly signals an intent to delegate power to resolve the ambiguity to the agency. One of that is acknowledged and accepted as a fiction. And it's in the teeth, by the way, of Section 706, as Professor Nielsen has said. But the court has been very schizophrenic, actually, about the kind of power, legislative or judicial, that Congress has supposedly delegated through ambiguous statutes. Chevron itself suggests both answers. The rule of deference is at times framed in Chevron in terms of judicial power. The Chevron court speaks of an agency's construction of the statute which it administers, and the agency is described as offering an interpretation of an ambiguous statute's meaning, clearly judicial functions. Yet elsewhere, the Chevron court states the rule of deference is based on a legislative delegation that involves reconciling conflicting policies and adopting wise policy. And those things are quintessentially exercises of legislative power and antithetical to the judicial function, at least as I understand it. Chevron's conflation of legislative and judicial power, interpretive power, has persisted throughout the entire line of Chevron cases. And I won't trudge through this phenomenon, but in the most recent case, one of them anyway, City of Arlington against FCC, you can see this in every other paragraph where the court describes what the agency is doing in interpretive judicial terms, and then in the next paragraph describes it in terms of legislative policymaking, fill in the gaps terms. Chevron's delegation rationale then is of two minds as to whether an agency that fills up the gaps created by an ambiguous law is making law or interpreting law. But either way, Chevron deference raises serious constitutional questions, for it was precisely to keep these fundamentally different governmental powers separate and to separate them from the executive power that the framers vested them exclusively in three separate branches. It's really as simple, frankly, as General Paxton suggested in his remarks. And I'm just here to put a little bit of flesh on that bone. But let's turn first to Article 3. To the extent that Chevron rests on a supposed implicit delegation of judicial power to administrative agencies, it's at war with Article 3. Recall that under Chevron, any reasonable agency construction of an ambiguous statutory provision is controlling, even over a contrary construction by the Supreme Court. Recall also that Article 3 opens with this sentence: the judicial power of the United States shall be vested in one Supreme Court and in such inferior courts as Congress may from time to time ordain and establish. Now, it seems clear to me anyway from this language that Congress could not create an inferior court with power to construe ambiguous laws in a manner binding on the Supreme Court. That would seem to invert this Article III directive. Well, surely Congress cannot create an executive agency with such judicial power. But the constitutional problem presented by Chevron is more fundamental than this. Congress cannot dispense or delegate something that it does not have. Congress does not have power to issue a judicially binding interpretation of its own laws. It is, you may be familiar with this proposition, it is emphatically the province and duty of the judicial department to say what the law is. As Alexander Hamilton wrote in Number 78, the interpretation of the laws is the proper and peculiar province of the courts. It therefore belongs to them to ascertain the meaning of any particular act proceeding from the legislative body. So I believe Justice Thomas was right in his concurrence in Perez, referenced earlier, when he said that because Congress lacks the judicial power itself, it cannot delegate that power to an agency. And there's a second, I think, very strong argument that Chevron violates Article 3, even apart from this non-delegation concern. And that view was first articulated by Professor Philip Hamburger, whose fairly recent book is Administrative Law Unlawful, is a masterful treatment. I refer all of you to it, particularly insofar as it deals with the history of administrative law and in particular, deference. But and it's also been recently embraced by Justice Thomas. But under this view of Article 3, Chevron is an impermissible abdication of judicial duty. When a judge defers to an agency at step two, the judge relinquishes his independent judgment and subordinates his own views to those of the agency. But the agency doesn't have, the agency bureaucrats don't have Article 3 protections for salary and life tenure, the necessary prerequisites to, under the Constitution, to the exercise of judicial power. Now let's turn to Article 1. This is a tougher question. To the extent that Chevron's rule of deference is based on a supposed implicit congressional delegation of legislative power, its validity has to be assessed against Article 1's unforgiving and very clear terms. All legislative powers herein granted shall be vested in a Congress of the United States. The term all admits of no exceptions. And at one time, the Supreme Court faithfully enforced this language, holding that the doctrine forbidding the delegation of Congress's legislative power to the executive branch was, quote, a principle universally recognized as vital to the integrity and maintenance of the system of government ordained by the Constitution. And so it was. Now, of course, it is no longer, at least as a practical matter, the non-delegation doctrine has lain dormant since the 1930s. The Supreme Court's repeated approval of very broad delegations of legislative power to administrative agencies is primarily responsible for the extraordinarily powerful one-branch government that we have today called the administrative state. But there may be a sign of hope here. In King against Burwell, the court's analysis may well signal a kind of de facto partial revival of the non-delegation doctrine, at least for interpretive questions that deal with deep, I'm quoting from King, deep economic and political significance. In that case, you'll recall it was whether or not there are tax credits available under the ACA for individuals who got their health insurance from a federal exchange, notwithstanding the fact that the language of the statute says only those who obtain their insurance from exchanges established by a state are qualified. The court said, well, this question, though, is of such existential to the statute significance that Congress couldn't possibly have intended implicitly to delegate this resolving the ambiguity to the executive branch. And so the court took the issue up into its own hands and using the usual canons of statutory construction came up with its decision. I think its reasoning, to say the least, is deeply flawed, but its rejection of Chevron in that context, I think, is a welcome development. Well, and so with that, I will subside. My time is well expired. Thank you very much.
I shortchanged our young professors in my introductions, and I just want to point out Aaron Nielsen, clerk on the U.S. Supreme Court, as did Aditya, and they're both prolific scholars, so don't think I'm making fun of them. As a, you know, as Ronald Reagan said to Jimmy Carter, I don't hold your youth and inexperience against you.
And I was elected to show that I clerk for Justice Roberts.
There you go. And I didn't even get to clerk on a circuit court, so what the heck. I do have a couple questions. As it's customary in the Federalist Society, we'll go back along the panel and give each person a few minutes to make some comments about the other speakers, but a couple things occurred to me as we were going through this. I second and commend to your reading Philip Hamburger's book, which he has, to me, he's an incredible scholar, and he goes back into the history of James I and before that in order to demonstrate that the founders were well aware of the problem of mixing the legislative and judicial and determinations within the power of the king that resulted in the Glorious Revolution. Second, but this is more pertinent to the panel, Judges Sutton and Judge Gorsuch have just written opinions that have gotten quite a bit of publicity. Judge Sutton on the business of hybrid rules, where the agency issues a ruling based on Chevron and it has criminal law consequences as well as civil. In this case was immigration. And the rule of lenity is normally applied to interpretations of the law for criminal purposes. And as we know, just about every administrative regulation can, if violated, put people in jail. So how does Chevron apply to hybrid rules, or should the court start looking at that? And also, Judge Gorsuch made the point in another immigration case about the fact that the agency had basically thumbed its nose in the face of the Tenth Circuit. And maybe these gentlemen can illuminate my understanding, but my experience has always been that where agencies from the IRS to the DOJ, to the immigration services, have received an unfavorable interpretation from the law in one circuit, they would abide by that interpretation and then press their own interpretation in other circuits. So they didn't feel nationally bound, but they felt circuit bound, and therefore they, until they got a case to the Supreme Court, they would continue to defer. But in the Tenth Circuit, it had issued an immigration decision, and the agency had come back and given a reinterpretation or a reconfirmation of whatever it was that the Tenth Circuit had overturned, and then it imposed it back in the Tenth Circuit. In other words, the Brand X horror, which is that the agency says, "Court, you're wrong. You know, we disrespect you, and therefore you've got to change your view." And that's what prompted Judge Gorsuch's concurrence. So with that, I turn it to Professor Van Vliet.
Well, thanks, Judge Jones. I very much enjoyed everybody's comments. And rather than responding on sort of a micro level, I think that one thought that I had while I was listening to everybody and crystallizing my own thoughts on this issue is, on a macro level, how should we think about these kinds of administrative law issues? And the way that I have tried and am trying to approach them is, what's the right answer? What's the right answer in terms of the legal text that we're presented with and how best to interpret that legal text? And where that leads us, whether that somehow has good consequences for taming the administrative state or bad consequences, well, the chips fall where they may, you know, at the end of the day, in terms of what Article III requires and what the APA requires. And conceivably,
the removal, as Judge Jones pointed out in her opening remarks, there was a time when Chevron was a very important decision by the Reagan administration, fully embraced well before my time, but I'm sure that many of you remember that. And so the ultimate point is that I'm not sure that this issue will be a panacea one way or the other on the broader issues. And the way in which courts really should approach the question, and this goes to kind of broader methodological points, is to try and get at the right answer rather than engage in some sort of policy debates about the appropriate trade-offs between, you know, are administrative agencies a good thing or a bad thing. Just to respond really quickly to Judge Jones's raising of the Tenth Circuit opinion, which is a very interesting one. Judge Gorsuch's opinion in that case is really well worth your reading time. That opinion addresses some of the fallout from the Brand X case, as Judge Jones pointed out. And since the panel is half about Justice Scalia and the evolution of the Chevron doctrine, I just wanted to point out that Justice Scalia dissented in the Brand X case on many of the grounds that Judge Gorsuch now finds compelling in his concurring opinion. So I'll stop and I'll turn it over to Professor Beal.
Okay. This sure is a truly difficult issue in the sense of, I think the courts in good faith thought that adopting Chevron was a good thing, that it was, that it made sense that when you don't have an answer, when you don't have an answer, why not go with those who work in it day in and day out, and are overall concerned to the success of the program. However, listening to the other views, I can see where you can take a point of view that Chevron is unconstitutional, but I don't believe that it necessarily is so. I never hear anyone talk about never talk about Skidmore, and you know, Skidmore was in essence Chevron in the sense of if the interpretation was valid, if the agency thoroughly considered it and consistently applied it, the court would defer. And so we've really had agency deference for a long time. Even here in Texas, even though the Supreme Court said, no, we don't follow Chevron, they said our doctrine is very similar. And that is that if you've got a reasonable interpretation of an agency, the court will normally defer. I think, and again, this gets into the whole problem of whether you disagree with the administrative state at all. But if we're going to have the administrative state, consistency and stability, I think, is a valid thing. I think this doctrine preserves that. So as to the Tenth Circuit, I totally disagreed with Brand X. I don't see how we can have an agency trumping a judicial opinion. So. I was with Scalia on that.
My turn, and then you got it. All right. So I'm just going to go down the line on 3 points. The first point is the hybrid rules, the Judge Sutton view, which is if a statute or a regulation has criminal enforcement, well, then, you know what, we're done because the rule of lenity kicks in. I think there's a lot of force to that argument, but you don't have to change anything within the Chevron framework to get there. Step one of Chevron is you look at traditional tools of statutory interpretation. That surely includes the rule of lenity. The rule of lenity says that in statutes with criminal enforcement, the tie goes to the defendant. Well, if you're admitting ambiguity, then you can't get to step two because the rule of lenity at that point has already done the work. I think there's a lot of force to that reasoning. to the Tenth Circuit case that we're talking about, I want to add another. There's a Ninth Circuit case that was decided 2 weeks ago. It was a denial of rehearing in which 10 judges dissented from rehearing the Ninth Circuit. It only could happen in the Ninth Circuit. literally, there's no other court that has 10 dissents. Couldn't do it anywhere else. This case called Oregon Restaurant v. Perez, I believe. Judge O'Scanlan wrote the dissent. It's also worth reading. It's very much worth your time. It brings up some of the same issues. It was the Ninth Circuit had ruled against an agency interpretation of the Department of Labor. The Department of Labor then made a new regulation. We got a new panel in the Ninth Circuit, and now the law is different. And that tends to get the ire up of judges. So we'll see where that plays out. And the last one is, we've heard Professor Beal, Skidmore. I think people have different views on Skidmore, which that's maybe a panel for another day as to what exactly Skidmore means. Justice Scalia was of the view that Skidmore was a truism. Skidmore says that you defer to an agency to the extent that its interpretation is persuasive. And he says, well, okay, all right. Yeah, well, that's what I do. But on the other hand, there are other folks who have a view of Skidmore with a little bit more meat than that. So that's a question for another day, but it's worth thinking about.
All right. Well, thank you. Do we have anyone who wants? Sorry. Excuse me.
I don't have much to say, but I've got a little. And I would also shout out these recent decisions. I haven't seen the Ninth Circuit opinion that Professor Nielsen refers to, but I have read Judge Gorsuch's, for example. I really do recommend it as well. It's a masterful piece of work, in my opinion. But yeah, Skidmore's, I guess, another area where Professor Beal and I have a very good natured disagreement here in terms of what it means. I agree with Scalia. He just read the framing of the so-called Skidmore test. It just does seem to say, look, if the agency's analysis persuades me that their interpretation of this ambiguous statute is correct, presumably tested against the ordinary tools of statutory construction, well, then I'm going to affirm them. Okay. The other thing that I would like to kind of bring out is this, agree, I think, with something I think Professor Beal referenced, which is that, you know, judges like agencies, but agencies, obviously, they have an agenda. They have to. They're supposed to. That's why we have elections. There's nothing wrong with that. But judges are not supposed to. But the enterprise is to grope your way to the, as best you can, to the meaning of a statute, one that was presumably intended by the lawmaker, as best you can. And yeah, it's rarely a certain enterprise, but there's some, some analysis that are superior to others. And when the court can't come to a judgment about the meaning with some level of confidence that this is what this means, this is what was intended by the Congress, the lawmaker, then I believe that it should say, we don't have law here to apply. We don't have law here to apply. And on this score, I want to highlight the foundation on which Chevron was built. I'm going to quote from Chevron, where Justice Stevens explained how you might find a situation where the agency is basically at sea to do what it will. Perhaps Congress consciously desired the administrator to strike the balance at this level, the balance of conflicting policies, thinking that those with great expertise and charged with responsibility for administering the provision would be in a better position to do so. Perhaps it simply did not consider the question at this level. And perhaps Congress was unable to forge a coalition on either side of the question, and those on each side decided to take their chances with the scheme devised by the agency. For judicial purposes, it matters not which of these things occurred. i.e. we still defer to what the agency said. Now, that's not a recipe for agency bureaucratic lawmaking. What is? What is? It's basically saying, Congress didn't make a law here. They didn't make a law. Let's let the GS-16s over at the EPA make this law. Chevron is, if there's anything to the separation of powers, Chevron violates it.
So I'm going to say real fast, I'm looking over Chuck's shoulder before we get the questions, and I see his copy of Chevron. This should be in a museum. it's all marked up. It's a thing of beauty. It's worth it. Look at this.
I've been writing on this for a long time.
Okay, well, now we'll open the floor to questions. If anyone has questions, we've got about almost 15 minutes.
May it please the court. I'm Warren Norrett. I'm from Arlington. The question I had is, I always looked at the Ninth Amendment as that great unused piece of the Constitution. And then I see Chevron, and I see the Clean Water Act, and I see people saying that this agency can determine what's going to happen to all pieces of land on which water falls. And it seems to me as though if we were ever going to say that the Ninth Amendment has any implication to anything, anywhere, we should say if an agency is interpreting an ambiguous statute, that it should at some point say, does the agency actually have the power in the Constitution? And kind of like a rule of lenity works, if it's between the people and the agency and freedom, liberty, maybe we ought to have some element of recognition that the government should not be able, certainly an agency should not be able to run roughshod whenever it clearly doesn't have the, not only the agency power or the legal power, but the constitutional authority. I never see that talked about. We talk about the ink blot on the Ninth Amendment, but it's supposed to be this rule of interpretation. Could we not, in my reading, I've never seen a single opinion ever that had any reasoning where people talk about the Ninth Amendment, even though it's discussed in the shadows of the reasoning in Roe v. Wade and a number of other places. Why don't we ever see that? Thank you.
Chuck, put you on the spot.
Yeah. Well, the Ninth Amendment is indeed a protection of individual liberty. And my own study of the Ninth Amendment essentially means that any time, and I studied this pretty carefully, I referred to you to a article in the Chicago Law Review on this, but the essence of it is that the people have, whenever they have not essentially consented to a law by virtue of its enactment by Congress, exercising one of the powers that it has been given, the enumerated powers it has been given, people have a constitutional right to be free from whatever that law is. It is effectively the individual rights analog to the 10th Amendment and the states' rights. If we assume, though, that Congress is acting within its enumerated powers, I actually think the Ninth Amendment falls away as some kind of independent basis for striking down a congressional enactment. But I think this point you're raising has relevance to the point I was just making about the necessity for Congress to make the laws. After all, we have a system in which the people manifest their consent to be governed by those laws through the ballot box. The people have required that for a law to come into existence to bind them and to govern their lives, it has to go through the elaborate process of bicameral passage and presentment and agreement by the president or override. That's how law is made. It's not, we just haven't thought about it, or we haven't been able to agree among ourselves what it's going to be and surmount this finely wrought process of bicameral passage the way it was explicitly described in Chevron as the license that now gives the bureaucrats the authority to make that law. There's so many levels on which, it seems to me anyway, the administrative state is objectionable constitutionally, that we our time here can't possibly cover it. I will say this, though, Judge Gorsuch in this Tenth Circuit case deals with many of the anomalies.
Thank you. Okay, Elliot.
Thank you very much for your remarks this morning. As I was thinking about sort of the intro right of center debates about being pro-Chevron or sort of anti-Chevron, the thing that this panel sort of made me think about is, and what I want to know is, if this debate has to do with two conflicting conservative instincts about human nature, one being, to Professor Beal's point, the desire to defer to people who have experience and expertise, because epistemologically people know what they touch better than, say, the judiciary, who doesn't have to deal with that particular kind of administrative question on a detailed level, versus the conservative impulse to distrust the people for the same reasons that we had the Glorious Revolution. People will, in administrative agencies, engage in self-serving, and the incentives sort of will align with them abusing their power. And if there's any way to resolve that conflict between those two conservative instincts without taking the fourth branch out of the reality that we know today.
Yeah, Aaron?
I would like to add, there's another conservative instinct that I think is at play, and that's where I think Justice Scalia came at this, and that is there's humility in the judiciary as well, that they worry that their ability to do it. So Scalia, I mean, again, his views evolve over time, but early on, he has a dual argue article, which is a very strong defense of Chevron on the idea, a little bit like Judge Jones was saying, hey, who do we want to make national policy on, say, nuclear power? Do we want it to be the agency, or do we want to be the DC Circuit? And I think that's a little bit, so that's a third instinct. How to reconcile all of them, probably, you know, my instinct would be to go back to where Professor Baum's and I was, which was, we have legal tools, we have legal texts, we have history, and it's not really our job to just do this ad hoc and come up with the answer. No, we should follow the traditional tools of legal interpretation to get there. And I think that's, as for most problems, that's the right answer, is smart people have thought about this, and we have it built into the system, and let's see what the law actually says before we start freelancing.
Did you?
I would just say, hey, let's say we just go back and read 78 again. And
okay. So I think it's a great question, and I think there are two different overarching perspectives on this. But I've always thought of them as slightly different from the ones that you're reaching, mentioning. And it seems to me that on the one hand, there are people who think that the Chevron framework, and the framework is an institutional analysis type of framework, where, so this maps onto your expertise point, we are in a position to figure out who's in a better position to make the kind of decisions in any given case. And so you have extremely prolific, great professors who might nominally fall on the right, who analyze issues from this perspective. It's an institutional analysis style perspective. And then on the other hand, there's sort of a legalistic instinct. And the legalistic instinct is that, you know, maybe those decisions about institutional roles have already been struck in the text that we're discussing. And to the extent that they have, then we'll just use the rules that have been adopted in those texts in order to analyze those kinds of issues. So that's sort of the way that I look at the break between different factions on this issue.
Anybody else?
I'm John Hayes, and I, among other things, spend a lot of time practicing administrative law. And the question relates to something that was touched on earlier, but then somewhat tends to get glossed over, namely the substantial evidence standard of review in both the federal and the Texas Administrative Procedure Act. And indeed, we frequently hypothesize that there's a bright line between questions of law and questions of fact, and of course that's not really true, especially when you have statutes that tell an agency to establish a reasonable rule for the control of water pollution, for instance. And it, certainly in my experience, the blurring of that line and the use of the substantial evidence test blows away, in many respects, the concerns about Chevron deference. So I'd be interested in comments on that.
That's a terrific question, and there are cases addressing this whole law fact point that go all the way back to early in the 19th century, and it's a bit of a muddle, and conceivably something where there could be more work about whether the substantial evidence rule can be adopted in all classes of cases, or there are limitations on that in Article 3 itself. The one other point that I note on this is that leading up to the Administrative Procedure Act, there were a number of cases, Gray versus Powell and NLRB versus Hearst. These are from 1941, 1944, at the same date as Skidmore, which is a case that Professor Beal has mentioned a couple of times. And those cases address precisely the point that you're raising, which is that we have a legal standard for questions of law, we have a deferential standard for questions of fact, and frankly, we can't tell whether this is a question of law or a question of fact, and so we're just going to defer. That's more or less the analysis in the cases. And there's an interesting interaction between those cases and then what ultimately becomes the APA. 2 years later, in 1946, the APA is enacted. And the way that I look at it, and there's some contemporaneous articles around the time of the APA, on this point, that the APA is intended to reject some of those precedents. So the Gray versus Powell NLRB versus Hearst line of cases. It's a very complicated point, and you're absolutely right that what is law and what is fact is not easy to decide in this situation, as it sometimes isn't easy to decide in the judge versus jury circumstance. And so it's a big question that needs to be addressed.
Yeah, I would say I assign my students universal camera, my administrative law students, which is the kind of the quintessential Supreme Court case on substantial evidence. And of all the cases I assign in all the classes I teach, that is the one that leaves people most confused. Because you read it, and you read it again, and you read it again, and you read it again, and you still don't know the answer. And the court effectively admits as much. So they say it's a move. What do you do with the mood?
Why are you signing that anyway?
Because it's the law.
I'll bring back my mood ring. I saw someone else. Does someone else have a question? I'll tell you the quintessential, I mean, what John and I were in law school together, what he's saying about the law fact business, you know, one of the first things you encounter when you go on the federal bench is Social Security cases, and you don't really think about, well, there's a five-step sequential process to determine whether there's a disability or not a disability, and you don't really think, well, what is a disability? And, you know, that, so you just, we just routinely accept the finding or the not finding, saying substantial evidence is more than a scintilla, you know, less than preponderance or whatever. So it's a very easy habit to get into of making that kind of differential choice. All right, well, if we have no more questions, we're about at our time limit anyway. So thank you very much. This was a great panel.